Today is a day that Hugh envisioned, and his expressed desire was that we would come together this afternoon as his family members and friends, certainly to extend comfort to Bobby and their family, but that we would also come to worship the Lord Jesus Christ. And we've already seen Hugh's personality and devotion that he had for the Lord in that song, Guardian of My Soul. And you will continue to see throughout this service Hugh's stamp on all of these proceedings. Thank you for being here and for participating in this celebration of Hugh's life. Following our time in the sanctuary this afternoon, there will be a reception in the fireside room, and Bobby and her family would invite you to stay and reminisce and reflect on the life of our dear friend Hugh McCullough. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die." That's our hope. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, God of all comfort, Father of compassion, we leap into your arms today, and we pray that you would embrace us with those everlasting arms, that you would be our refuge and our strength and our comfort. We thank you for Hugh's life, for the example of a faithful servant who followed you with such passion and with such devotion. And I pray that today, as we reflect on his life, and as we meet together, that you, in a way, would use each and every one of us as agents of your healing and comforting grace to one another. We thank you that you are here. We celebrate your presence today. We celebrate the fact that even though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, that we don't need to fear any evil because you're with us every step of the way. So we pray, Lord, that you would be glorified and honored. We know that that would fulfill Hugh's wishes for this day. We thank you for the hope that he had and the hope that we have. And we pray it in the name of your Son, Jesus, the one who conquered sin and conquered death. Amen. Amen.
Hugh John McCullough, June 9th, 1942, December 14th, 2023. I was born in Hamilton, Ontario on June 9th, 1942. I am predeceased by my parents, Hugh and Elsie McCullough, and my sister, Gail Ann Durah. Being a war baby was not the easiest way to start to life. My parents and I resided between Hamilton, Ontario, and Ottawa during the years my father, a member of the Royal Canadian Air Force Military Band, served in Ottawa. After World War II, our family of three settled in Hamilton, Ontario, and began to live a Leave It to Beaver life. My sister Gail was born into the family on May 7th, 1947. In December 1953, our family moved to Toronto, where we lived until 1959, as my father continued his military band career. In 1959, we once again packed up and moved to Ottawa, where my father retired from his military banding career and took up a position as a school music teacher. In October 1961, I followed in the footsteps of my father and joined the Royal Canadian Air Force as a musician. My banding career began in Victoria, as a student of the Royal Canadian Navy School of Music. It was during this time I met a young lady whom I married in July 1964. We took up residence in Ottawa, where I was a member of the Royal Canadian Air Force Central Band. Leslie and I continued to reside in Ottawa until 1976, and it was during these years that we were blessed with three children. I am so thankful for all the joy my children and their partners have given me over the years. Sherry Lynn Robertson and Gary, Daryl and Steph, Greg and Nancy, and subsequently two grandsons, Liam and Noah Robertson. In the summer of 1976, my family of five were on the move again, moving back to Victoria, where I served as French horn instructor at the newly named Canadian Forces School of Music. During this time, I also performed with the Victoria Symphony Orchestra as a member of the French horn section. I was later transferred to Calgary, Alberta, as a member of the Princess Patricia Canadian Light Infantry Band, and I received my commission to captain while serving with this organization, and was once again transferred back to Victoria, holding various positions at the School of Music. 1986 saw me transferred once again, this time to Halifax, Nova Scotia, where I assumed the position of commanding officer, director of music of the Stadacona Band of the Royal Canadian Navy, where I served for 2 years. I subsequently served in a number of positions within various units of the Navy in Victoria, followed by stints in Camp Borden, which is north of Toronto, and in Ottawa. My last position with the military, 1992 to 1994, was that of commanding officer, director of music of the Naden Band of Maritime Forces Pacific here in Esquimalt. I retired from the military after 33 years of service in 1994. On March 24th, 1993, Bobby and I were married. She is the love of my life. She has blessed me, and over these last 30 years, she has demonstrated nothing but true love and support. This relationship also came with three wonderful children, adult children, and their partners, Doug and Sheila, Cheryl, Debbie, and Sean, along with six grandchildren and their partners, Joshua, Christian and Jenna, Sarah and Aaron, Brooklyn, Shaylin, and Levi. After my retirement from the military, I tried various jobs, from chauffeuring for a funeral home to school teaching. Bobby and I finally took up the position of custodian, groundskeeper, and looked after the security of this, the Victoria First Church of the Nazarene, our church. We served in this position for some 20 years. I was so blessed to be able to lead annual Christmas cantatas and the Christmas Brass Sunday each Advent, while Bobby led Kids Church, Bugs, beautiful, unique girls, women's retreats, and workshops. We were busy together and enjoyed every moment working side by side. I am saddened by what death leaves behind. Family, friends, and the many folk we loved and crossed paths with over the years. Yet I am thankful for how He, our Lord and Savior, has provided for me and my beautiful family all these years. A new home has called.
Why do I do just as you say? Why must I just give you your way? Why do I sigh? Why don't I try to forget? It must have been that something lovers call fate kept me saying I had to wait. I saw them all, just couldn't fall till we met. It had to be you. It had to be you. I wandered around and I finally found the somebody who make me be true, and could make me be blue, and even be glad just to be sad, thinking of you. Some others I've seen might never be mean, might never be cross or try to be boss, but they wouldn't do. For nobody else gave me a thrill. With all your faults, I love you still. It had to be wonderful you. It had to be you.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for coming this afternoon. Hugh selected a few specific songs for our corporate time of worship this afternoon, so I'm going to invite you to stand, and if you want to sit partway through this, feel free. But let's stand together, and we'll make our way through these songs and sing about a wonderful God who knows all things, who's above all things, and is seeing us through all things right now. There's just something about thy name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like the fragrance after the rain. Jesus, 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 let all heaven and earth proclaim. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something about that name. Sing that one more time. Jesus, 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 there's just something about the name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like the fragrance after the rain. Jesus, 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 let all heaven proclaim. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something about that name. Let us praise Jesus, now we are standing in His presence, holy ground. Let's sing that one more time. We're standing. We are standing on holy ground, and I know there are angels all around. Let us pray. Standing in His presence and hold the ground. This is holy ground. We're standing on holy ground. The Lord is here, and where He is holy. This is holy ground. We're standing on holy ground. For the Lord is here, where He is holy. We're standing. We are standing on holy ground, and I know there are angels all around. Let us pray.
Standing face to face, I look upon your countenance, see the fullness of your grace. I can only bow down and say, you are awesome in this place, mighty God. You are awesome in this place. I'm a father. You are worthy of all praise. To you our lives we raise. You are awesome in this place, mighty God. As I come into your presence and pass the gates of praise, into your sanctuary to stand face to face, and I look upon your countenance, see the fullness of your grace. I can only bow down and say, you are awesome in this place, mighty God. You are awesome in this place, Abba Father. You are worthy of all praise. To you our lives we raise. You are awesome in this place, mighty God. Amen. Seated.
Thank you, Doug. One of the memories I have of Hugh is that anytime he would hear a song or a scripture or someone saying something that either resonated with him or had meaning, he would close his eyes and he would just take it in. You could see him doing that. And one of the last times I was with Bobby and Hugh and I read scripture with them, I looked over at Hugh and his eyes were closed. And he was taking it in, the truth of God's word, bringing comfort to him. And one of his wishes is that together as a congregation, we read Psalm 23. And we're going to do that in a second. But just before we read it, I want us to imagine Hugh closing his eyes, taking it in, because he believed it. It was his comfort. It was his hope. And I know that he would want those words to resonate in our lives too today and to be our comfort and our hope. So please stand. We're going to read Psalm 23 together. It is located in the back of your memorial folder. So we can stand, or it's going to be on the screen and you can read along with me. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. You may be seated. We're going to be listening to a song that Hugh and Bobby wanted to have played. And they wanted it to be a time to just express thanks. Thanks to all the people that for 15 years, as they struggled through health challenges, that you were there for them, that you were lifting them up in prayer. And also with the death of their son Joshua, Joshua, which was just such a tragic time for them. There were so many prayers and ways that people stood for them. And so this song, as we listen to it as words they chose for all of you to meditate on.
I could not pray. I wasn't quite prepared. I thought it was Greg, so it was first. Anyhow, again, thank you for coming and joining our family today. I have to be honest, I had really, really struggled with what to say. I'd write something out and then I would delete it. I would type it out and delete it. It happened at least a half a dozen times. And then my daughter-in-law, Steph, told me to just write from my heart. Oh boy. That's when I realized I was writing about the difficult times, the frightening moments we went through over the past 12 years, how death so often seemed to be right around the corner, about how he would rise like the phoenix out of the ashes again and again, about the moments when things seemed to be at their very darkest and God would be there, at times very, very present, providing all that we needed and more than we even asked for. All of this is true, but I don't think those are the moments that Hugh would want me to share with you today. He would want me to tell you that he had a wonderful, joy-filled, rich life. He would want us to look at the glimpses of his life and the photos that you saw earlier, and to be honest, I can hear him say, "Holy Hannah, that was a long video." He would have cut it by half, but there were a couple of things he had no say over today, and that was the video and what I say and Greg say. So anyhow, we took liberty. He thought you'd be bringing out popcorn, I'm sure. He would have shortened that for sure. Those photos, though, revealed some of the joy and the love the two of us experienced as we celebrated our lives together. Was he ill and struggling during some of those times? He was. In fact, in some of those places and those times, and on some of those exact days, actually, he was heading to the ER in an ambulance, or he was being cut loose from ER. But as you can see, nothing stopped him. If there was a way to be at an event, a celebration, to hang out with our family, he was not going to miss it. And those photos speak to a life rich in family and friends. Many celebrations and events were booked far down the road, and even in those tenuous times, we would put it in the calendar, make the reservations, and start preparing. A perfect recent example would be when we got a call in the fall from our in 2021 from our grandson, Christian. He was letting us know that he'd be running a half Ironman in Oregon in June of 22. I have to be honest, I did not think we were going to make it. But our response was, we're going to be there. We charged forward, we made the reservations, and we made plans to pick up family at the airport in Vancouver. And I was very nervous about that because they were counting on us. And we made that drive down to Oregon in that huge Lincoln MKT, which I hated that car. But it worked out really well for that trip. And Hugh had a blast, we all did. And as Christian headed for that finish line, you saw it in those photos, he saw Grandpa reaching out to him. I was surprised Hugh didn't tumble over the barrier, in fact, but the photographer caught their hands touching in a high five. Christian won't forget that, and Hugh relived it many times. Hugh began attending the liver clinic at the Royal Jubilee Hospital about every 2 weeks starting in February. It was not a chore for him to go. He looked forward to his appointments, actually. He was treated like royalty. The nurses, Roz, Joan, and Arlene, would dote on him, seriously. As soon as he climbed into the bed, he'd be asked, "Would you like a warm blanket?" "Oh, yes, please." "Would you like some cranberry juice?" "Oh, that'd be nice." "With ice?" "Yes, please." "Would you like another warm blanket?" "Would you like a drink here?" "How about a cookie to go with that?" "Another warm blanket?" It was crazy. It was unbelievable. And when their holidays, he knew everything. When their holidays were booked, he knew how many kids they had, what their favorite activities were, and so they doted on him. And then there was Dr. Jessica, a young doctor with a little two-year-old. We hadn't seen her for a few visits, so that would have been a good month and a half. And Hugh was well into his disease. She came into the room and headed straight for Hugh. She sat down, told him how happy she was to see him on the appointment list today, and she reached over and held his hand, telling him how remarkable he was And then she asked if she could hold my hand. And to be honest, I thought she was going to pray with us. But she didn't, and that was that would have been fine. But she just had more to say to the two of us with tears in her eyes. One day, Roz, the nurse, came in and said, "What is it about you, Hugh, that everyone loves you?" What indeed? On a beautiful day in February of 23, Hugh asked me if I'd like to go for coffee at the Marigold Cafe. So we walked over, took a table outside. It was that lovely, that February day here. And Hugh went in to get our coffees. He came back, sat down, and he said, "Babe, we really need to get our heads around death. No one is getting out of here alive, and the way things are going, it looks like I'm going to be first." I looked at him and said, "Honestly, I thought we were just coming for a coffee, like really." Anyhow, a couple of weeks later, at the liver clinic, we were told the trajectory of his disease. And from then on, I would say that we looked death straight in the eye. We talked about it. We planned for it. Hugh put this service together in July, I think it was. He made his funeral arrangements. We had Pastor Gary over. Hugh went over the service with him. And Gary said, "Okay, this is on the shelf. Now you live." And I believe that we did. In January 23, just before we began all the appointments at the liver clinic, we were invited to come and celebrate Christine Neal's milestone birthday. And I want to thank you for that evening, Christine, because it's a memory I will hold close. Christine is Pastor Dave's wife. It was held at Brent and Elise's beautiful home, and what an evening it was. Friends, music, food, drinks, perfect combination for a great time. Hugh was looking very handsome and dapper in his turtleneck sweater and his sport coat. I can still see him. He settled himself nicely down into the big, comfy leather couch in the big open area by the kitchen. I was bringing him his foods, his drinks, and he seemed to be holding court over there all evening. Every time I looked over, someone else was sitting beside him chatting away. At one point, as I handed him some more food, he said, "Babe, look around this place. You're the oldest broad here." Okay, so only Hugh could get away with a statement like that. But I looked around and he was right. I was the oldest broad there. Anyhow, during that evening, when the crowd was starting to thin out a bit, I was sitting beside Dave Bacharach. And we were talking about something, I don't know. And out of nowhere came Hugh. He had finally managed to get himself off that comfy couch. He reached over, took my hand, and said to Dave, "Excuse me, but I need this lady." He held my hand and led me over to the dance floor. That was the last dance we had. Sorry. And it upsets me. I can't remember this song. But there we were, just the two of us, the oldest couple there, on the dance floor dancing and just looking into each other's eyes. I was his lady, and he was definitely my man. He went by ambulance on December 8th to the Saanich Peninsula Hospital. When I got there, I was told that the paramedic had asked him what his favorite color was. And he said, "My wife." So, I was his lady, and in his final days, I found out I was also his favorite color. I didn't know that. We, all of his adult children, his grandchildren, his sister and brother-in-law, his cousins, his friends, and his lady have all been blessed and beautifully touched by this man. He will be missed.
Thank you, Bobby. That was beautiful. A beautiful tribute. I've been asked to read a tribute from Hugh's son Gregory on behalf of their family. This is from Greg. "As I write this, I'm envisioning the many friends, family, and colleagues that have gathered here today to celebrate Dad. This room, this holy place that Dad loved to be in, filled with those whose lives were touched by Dad in one way or another. Family, fellow church members, military colleagues, and friends. You were all so important to him. Bobby told us once that when Dad left the house, he'd always make sure he had change in his pockets for those less fortunate. I think of Dad as always being prepared to be there for anyone, selfless and kind to everyone at all times. Over my 51 years of memories, I often reminisce of an activity I love so much with Dad. It may sound cliche, but out of the Kevin Costner movie Field of Dreams, but times as a youngster playing catch one-on-one with Dad always stands out to me. Dad had a way of doing things to perfection. No showboating, no boasting. Our first house here in Victoria had a small strip of grass next to the driveway. I'd always stand to the end that leads to the backyard, and Dad would always stand at the roadside. Dad had the end that was downhill behind him, so when I threw the occasional wayward ball, you can guess how much he enjoyed chasing that ball down. For a moment, he'd give the puckered lips and ruffled eyebrows before he went chasing it down. That's about as frustrated as you'd ever see Dad get. Nancy and I chuckle and smile about it when I tell her that story because it seems so out of character for him. He had a great temperament in all situations. When it was Dad's turn to throw the ball, he threw the ball perfectly every time. The ball always landed in the exact center in the pocket of my glove. It was not because I had any extraordinary skills catching, but because Dad could pitch a great ball. Seemingly with no effort. So much Dad did. He did it so well. He just did it so well. In turn, with every pitch he threw, he made me feel better than I was. I felt like $1 million when Dad was throwing to me, building confidence in me and teaching valuable lessons of how to be. I know Daryl likely experienced the same. Though from what Daryl has told me, Dad taught him how to catch those very, very fast balls, and man, did Daryl's hands sting after catching those. Dad could throw a real zinger, too. I think he went a bit easier on Cher as well for her softball practice. Dad taught us the joy of fishing, many wonderful experiences and memories from our time on the boat. Recently, Daryl and I bought a boat we have up at Gabriola, and Dad recently obtained his PCOC, Pleasure Craft Operator's Card. He sails the high seas as a mate and captain of the ship. This does not change his PCOC card is on board and ready to set sail. Dad's illness prevented him from getting out to land another big one with us, but we did get to hang out with Dad in the boat at the dock. How we would have enjoyed another fishing day with Dad. He will be with us on every trip, guiding our boat. Dad's love of music that he got from Papa, his father, didn't seem to carry on with Cher, Daryl, and me. When we played our various instruments, he'd be there instructing us again and again with that perfect pitch. His musical skill seemed to come so naturally to him. Even though I didn't relate much to Dad's music interests, I would feel great pride when I saw Dad up there playing his French horn or leading his bands as director of music. So many of you here right now had a part in Dad's great achievements on stage, whether it be from his early days in the military or right here on this stage. He loved sharing his joy of music with the choir and the small brass bands with whom he worked. Cher, Daryl, and I were always proud of our dad. We admired how he managed everything he did. Cher, Daryl, and I share a style of leadership in our jobs. Those who work for or with Cher and Daryl have said how much they always feel respected and appreciated by them. Great leadership and respect. We learned that from Dad. Many of you know the years he spent here caring for this property. He took great pride in it, and it certainly showed. He worked hard at everything he did. The day Dad passed away, Sheila and I were in the sitting room of palliative care at Saanich Peninsula Hospital. A new nurse sat with us for a few moments asking about Dad and the family dynamics. Sheila described us as kind of a Brady Bunch kind of group. I hadn't thought of that before, but it's true, so true. Dad and Bobby's family dynamics changed when they united together, and over their 30 years, we witnessed Dad's love, caring, and guidance. Dad cared deeply for his family. I know the love, the lessons have rubbed off on us. Dad carries on through generations. Thank you for being the example of how to be our confident, endearing guide, always delivering that perfect pitch. A great man and a great father. Love you and miss you every day.
It is my time. I was out of sync for a bit. Why don't you stand with me, and we're going to sing this song, 10,000 Reasons. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I'll worship your holy name. Let's sing this together.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. Reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and and my time has come. And still my soul will sing praise. 10,000 years, then forevermore. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. Well, I worship Your holy name. Yes, I worship Your holy name. Amen. Be seated.
Thank you, Doug. Every aspect, every detail of this celebration of life has been carefully thought out and planned. Actually, there's a better way to describe it. Every aspect, every detail of this celebration of life has been beautifully orchestrated by Hugh. It's fitting, isn't it, that the commanding officer and director of music of the Stadacona Band of the Royal Canadian Navy, that the commanding officer and director of music of the Naden Band of Maritime Forces Pacific, that the one who in this church led the Christmas brass ensemble at the beginning of each Advent season, that the one who led countless Christmas choir cantatas, it's fitting, isn't it, that Hugh would orchestrate His own celebration of life. This past July, as Bobby mentioned, Hugh invited me to come to their place to specifically to go over the plans for this service today. And Hugh got out his computer and he played for me every video, every song that is played. I think of that song that was played at the very beginning today, Guardian of My Soul. He showed me the video and he pointed out to me, now this is when I want Bobby and the family to come into the sanctuary. It was that detailed. Hugh thought through every aspect and every detail of this service, and he told me with a determined look on his face, he says, I want this to be a worship service. I want God to be glorified. There's a verse of scripture in Matthew chapter 18 where Jesus is talking to his followers. And he tells them that when they come together and they agree with one another, he says, when they come together in my name and you agree, he says, I'm going to show up. And the word in that passage for agree is the Greek word symphoneo, from which we get the English word symphony. That's what we're participating in this afternoon. We've come together in agreement. We're united in purpose. We all want God to use us as agents of His comfort to you, Bobby, and to your wonderful family. And we all agree that we want to express gratitude to God for the profound blessing of Hugh's friendship. We all agree that we want Jesus, the Good Shepherd, to show up and tell us that even when we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, that we don't need to fear any evil because He's with us every single step of the way. We're united in purpose today. We've come together in Jesus' name, and we agree. And in these moments, we find ourselves participating in this harmonious symphony of common purpose. It's kind of like God has written the score and Hugh is directing it. And we're all playing our parts. Different parts, different instruments, different notes, but all harmoniously bringing glory to God in the celebration of the beautiful life of our dearly beloved Hugh. All of us, the people that came yesterday to clear the parking lot and the sidewalks. You know, as one who was custodian and groundskeeper and in charge of security, Hugh would want me to mention them. That's part of the symphony. Those who've set up things in the fireside room, those who designed and printed and folded the memorial folders, the sound technicians, the video projectionists, the ushers, the greeters, Hugh's friend Rick, who read his life story in the first person, Bobby's son Doug leading our worship today, Pastor Sylvia leading us through, all of us through the reciting of the 23rd Psalm, and Bobby, your tribute. What a beautiful, beautiful tribute. And Gregory, those beautiful sentiments that you expressed. And the closing song that Hugh selected, Deb, flying back to be here today, to be a part of this. It's so fitting as one who in many ways picked up the torch from Hugh in leading our seasonal choirs. I'm anticipating that in a few moments, as you lead us to the grand finale in that crescendo of praise to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that will be a pretty significant part of the symphony. And Pastor Dave, as you do so well as our pastor in bringing the benediction, we anticipate that God will speak through you a word from him that will bring blessing and comfort and hope. We're part of this beautiful symphony this afternoon. And I realize in all of this that Hugh also assigned to me a part. He wants me to sound a note of hope, that because Jesus, the one who conquered sin, the one who conquered death, because of Jesus, Hugh is alive today. Did you get it? Hugh is alive today. There are five words, and Hugh just kind of slipped it in there. Five words at the very end of his life story. Five words that he wrote at the conclusion of those words that Rick read for us. These five words. A new home has called. It's like, when he wrote those five words, it's like he wanted to light a fuse on this mind-blowing concept of eternal life. Hugh was living every day of his life in anticipation of December 14, 2023. And on that day, he realized that a new home had called. About 15 years ago, after his mother, Elsie, passed away, Hugh's dad came to live in Victoria. Hugh's dad's name was also Hugh. His nickname was Shorty. Hugh obviously got his height from his mother. Hugh told me his dad was having a lot of questions about physical death and about eternity and about what happens to the soul when a person dies. And so Hugh set it up for the three of us to go to Romeo's for lunch. I looked back and I found some notes on my computer from that meeting in 2009. I think maybe 2009 or 2010. Don't worry, I don't keep notes on all of you, but I did in that case. We talked about verses like 2 Corinthians 5, 7, and 8, where the Apostle Paul says, "We live by faith, not by sight." And he goes on in that passage to say that we are confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord. And we also talked about how Jesus told the repentant thief on the cross, he said, "Today you will be with me in paradise." And we were talking about all this, and we were talking about it in the context of Hugh's mother, Elsie, about her death. But it wasn't long after that Hugh's father passed away, and I remember when we gathered together at the Salvation Army Citadel to celebrate what the Salvationists call his promotion to glory. It was several years later, more recently, we met in this very sanctuary to grieve and yet to celebrate the hope of eternal life in Hugh and Bobby's grandson, Josh. And in that service, a video was shown of Hugh and Josh together in the baptismal tank at Josh's baptism. The expression on Hugh's face, he was just beaming with joy. I bring that up because through all of these experiences, it was evident that Hugh thought deeply about life and about death, even when he'd go for coffee, and about life after death. And through the centuries, you know, humanity has struggled with this concept, but Hugh had no struggle with it. Through the centuries, humanity has struggled with concepts that go beyond reason, beyond rationality, beyond understanding, concepts like faith and eternal life. Philosophers and artists and poets and songwriters have wrestled to articulate those thoughts, and sometimes they've been very beautiful, but sometimes they give a pretty bleak view of things. I think of in the early 17th century, an English bard by the name of William Shakespeare penned this soliloquy uttered through the character Macbeth. He says, "Out, out, brief candle. Life's but a walking shadow, a poor player that struts and frets his hour upon the stage and then is heard no more. It is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing." Pretty bleak, isn't it? In the latter years of the 20th century, another English bard by the name of Elton John wrote a song called "Candle in the Wind." First in the 1980s, referencing the life of actress Marilyn Monroe and her tragic death. And then in 1997, in a tribute to Princess Diana at her funeral in 1997. Is life a candle that burns for a while and then goes out? It's hard to wrap our minds around the answer to that question because we can't see the other side, but the scriptures call us to live by faith and not by sight. Now, the scriptures tell us to be educated and informed. The Apostle Paul says, I don't want you to be ignorant about those who fall asleep or to grieve like the rest of people who have no hope. He doesn't want us to be ignorant. He wants us to think and wrestle with those things and come to a place of certainty, but at the same time, to embrace this mystery, the mystery of eternal life, as the Apostle Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 15. Listen, I tell you a mystery. The dead will be raised imperishable. As much as anybody that I've ever known, Hugh embraced both the mystery of eternal life and the certainty that he had, that he had received this gift through his Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That's why he said, "A new home has called." That's why he orchestrated for us to sing, "And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending 10,000 years and then forevermore." And that's why Hugh orchestrated for us to recite together, "Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." That's why Hugh would have each and every one of us come together in agreement this afternoon and experience the symphony of God's presence. That's why Hugh would have each and every one of us embrace both the mystery and the certainty that a new home has called. Praise the Lord. Praise His holy name. To God be the glory, now and forever. Praise His holy name.
Stand. Praise the
now here at the end of this wonderful celebration of Hugh's life. What a marvelous time we've had remembering him and his family. I'd like to bring a benediction, if I may. Now may God the Father and his love be with you. May the grace and peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be upon you. May the fellowship of the Holy Spirit walk with you today and be with you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And we invite you all to join us for refreshments in the fireside room. And as we go to our recessional, I'm going to ask the family to stay standing and the congregation to be seated, please.